So in the late 30s and early 40s, we're getting into this movement you mentioned, this musical development in jazz called bebop. You mentioned, you know, in some of her recordings, some of her groups, she's playing things that could be called proto-bebop, and she's writing tunes later on that kind of have bebop-esque melodies. So first, can you briefly explain to people what bebop is on a musical level? And secondly, can you talk about her mentorship of a number of really important bebop pianists? Because the first thing that really, I don't know, 8 or 9 years ago, sort of like made me like, okay, respect Mary Lou Williams, not knowing much about her, was reading a biography of Bud Powell by Peter Pullman, I think his name is. He mentioned that she was a mentor to Bud Powell, one of the most influential jazz pianists of all time, of course. Thelonious Monk, hugely influential as a jazz composer as well as a pianist. And Elmo Hope, who didn't have quite the legacy they did, although was a fine pianist. I definitely would love to know more about their relationship, but we should probably start with what bebop is in the first place.
Sure. Well, bebop, so if we're, say we were talking earlier about Andy Kirk and Count Basie and Benny Goodman, so we're talking about a period of time mostly in the late 20s and throughout the 30s, known as the swing era. So in this period, there, you know, people would go out for dancing, and they would often go out to hear big bands, so to dance at places like the Savoy Ballroom in New York. And bebop is actually, it's something that is more, it's usually with smaller groups. So say if you're thinking a trio, a quartet, a quintet with a couple horns, maybe like trumpet and saxophone, it's very more focused on, with a big band where you're more focused on the full ensemble. In bebops, you're more focused on the soloists, and there's a lot of technical virtuosity and very fast tempos. So people could certainly dance to some bebop, but it'd be much more difficult.
Yeah. They tried.
Yeah.
And they gave it their best effort.
And also the interesting thing is, you know, the time that bebop, that movement arose, I mean, very, very beginning of the 40s, there was a recording band for a couple of years in New York. So instrumentalists who were union members, which was most everybody, couldn't record new records. So the interesting thing is, you know, we haven't necessarily heard the earliest incarnations of bebop.
Right.
And Mary Lou, because of the time that she moves to New York, she moves in like 42, 43, right when the ban is happening. I mean,
That was because of the war, right?
No, well, that was because, so the Musicians Union, the American Federation of Musicians, basically the president of the union, James Petrillo, instituted this ban because of the rise of things like radio and jukeboxes in terms of popularity. So what was happening was that, and seeing records, this need for records, records were replacing. So, for instance, on radio, Mary Lou had her own radio show in 1945, and that was a fairly common thing for musicians to have their own show. She played live on the
Right.
show,
Right.
but live music was getting pushed out by recordings. So basically, the musicians' union wanted record labels to essentially pay royalties to the musicians who did the recordings that they were on.
Gotcha.
And if they didn't, then musicians could not record for them, and most of the major labels refused. So there were actually two different bands in the 40s. But when Mary Lou, when she moves to New York, I mean, it's right during that time. So that's also why we don't hear certain of her music from that period.
Right. So, what was her relationship? I mean, we know that Bud Powell and Thelonious Monk and some others would come over to her place and share ideas and get mentorship from her. I want to say that I heard something about, this is a vague memory, so correct me or make what I'm saying more precise if I'm wrong, but I feel like I read that Thelonious Monk was maybe going to go into the direction of having a more typical, like classical, informed touch on the piano, and she sort of discouraged him from losing his interesting, unique touch that he had. Is that true? I feel like I heard that somewhere.
I don't know that. I mean, it may be true, but I don't know that. What I do know is that so Mary Lou knew Monk from Kansas City, and she knew Charlie Parker from Kansas City. So, when she's in New York, and I mean, and Monk is also in New York, he is definitely one of the people where he said that he did not want to play some of his pieces in public until he had run them by Mary Lou first. So, yeah, it was definitely a happening that after hours, after gigs, many musicians will go to Mary Lou's apartment in Harlem, and she had a Baldwin upright piano that she had for her entire life, that I've actually seen because it's here in Pittsburgh at the Heinz History Center. But basically, people would come to her apartment, play pieces they were working on, and give feedback, and Mary Lou would give feedback. And that was something that was really important for people like Monk. It's also interesting because I think I talk about this in the book. There are tunes like, so in 1944, Mary Lou records her arrangement of George Gershwin's piece called Lady Be Good, and she writes a new melody for the chord changes, essentially. Well, that melody for jazz musicians basically know a lot of Monk tunes. They don't know a lot of Mary Lou tunes. But if you told a jazz musician, or if you called a tune on a gig or something and said, "Oh, do you know Hackensack?" Hackensack is da 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 da. Basically, that's Mary Lou's arrangement of Lady Be Good from 1944. And Hackensack
Wow.
wasn't recorded until the early 50s. Hawkins, who was playing tenor sax on that session with Mary Lou in 1944, he records his piece called Riftide the next year that's essentially the same melody.
And didn't Mary Monk rip a horn, melody, a melodic line from one of Mary Lou's Andy Kirk arrangements as well? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Rhythm and Ing is...
Yeah.
Yep. But you know, there was certainly a lot of borrowing, you know, that going on. And I don't think it was necessarily, I don't think it was malicious at all or anything.
Right.
But the issue... The issue is the, you know, the way we talk about history and the way things get passed down, because people think that the tune is by Thelonious Monk. And if I was to go to any jam session and call any Mary Lou tune, I can probably, you know, I mean, I would say that probably 95% of anywhere, even What's Your Story, Morning Glory, which is probably one of her best known tunes. No, I don't know that people would know it. And it's a real issue, because Monk is known as being, I mean, and he was a great composer, and his tunes are really fun to play. But I recorded some of Mary Lou's things on my new record called Force of Nature, tunes of hers from the 40s that you listen to the bridges and it's like, this sounds like Monk, but it's the other way around. You know, Monk sounds like Mary Lou. So I think that's something that's a real issue, because the other thing is that Mary Lou, yeah, she's known as being a mentor to these other more famous jazz musicians, which is like, okay, that's cool. She was a mentor. How does that relate to me as a 21st century jazz musician? If I don't know her music, you know, I don't know. If I don't know any of these tunes, I just know that she mentored these guys whose tunes I do know. I think that's a problem.
Right.